Simon & Schuster Audio presents Before I Say Goodbye by Mary Higgins Clark. Read by Jan Maxwell. Fifteen-year-old Nell MacDermott turned and began the swim back to shore. Her body tingled with youthful exhilaration as she looked about, taking in the glorious combination of the sun and the cloudless sky, the light fresh breeze, the salty foaming whitecaps breaking around her. She had been in Maui only an hour, but already had decided that she liked it better than the Caribbean, which for the past several years was where her grandfather had taken the family for their annual post-Christmas vacation. Actually, family seemed something of an exaggeration. It was the fourth year that their family had consisted of just her grandfather and herself. It had been 5 years ago when Cornelius MacDermott, legendary congressman from New York, had been called off the floor of the House of Representatives to be given the news that his son and daughter-in-law, both anthropologists on an expedition in the Brazilian jungle, had died in the crash of their small chartered plane. He immediately had rushed to New York to pick up Nell at school. It was news that she had to hear from him. He arrived to find his granddaughter in the nurse's office, weeping. "When we were coming in from recess this morning, I suddenly felt that Dad and Mommy were with me, and that they had come to say goodbye to me," she told him as he held her. "I didn't actually see them, but I felt Mom kiss me, and then Dad ran his fingers through my hair." Later that day, Nell and the housekeeper who took care of her when her parents were away had moved into the brownstone on East 79th Street, the place where her grandfather had been born and where her father had been raised. Nell flashed briefly on these memories as she began her swim back to shore and to her grandfather, who was sitting in a beach chair under an umbrella, having reluctantly acquiesced to her plea for one quick swim before they unpacked.
"Don't go out too far," he had cautioned as he opened his book. "It's 6 o'clock and the lifeguard is leaving."
Nell would have liked to stay in the water longer, but she could see that the beach was almost deserted now, and she knew that in a few minutes her grandfather would realize he was getting hungry and start to get impatient, especially since they hadn't even unpacked. Long ago, her mother had warned her that any situation that left Cornelius MacDermott both hungry and tired was to be avoided. Even from a good distance out, Nell could see that he was still deeply absorbed in his book. She knew, though, that it wouldn't last much longer. "Okay," she thought as she picked up her stroke, "let's make waves." Suddenly, she felt disoriented, as if she were being turned around. What was happening to her? The shore disappeared from view as she felt herself being yanked from side to side, then pulled under. Stunned, she opened her mouth to call for help, but immediately found herself swallowing salty water. Sputtering and choking, she gasped for breath, struggling to keep afloat. Riptide. While her grandfather was checking in at the front desk, she had overheard two bellmen talking about it. One of them said that there'd been a riptide on the other side of the island last week, and that two guys had drowned. He said that they died because they fought against the pull, instead of letting themselves get carried out until they were beyond it. A riptide is a head-on collision of conflicting currents. As her arms flailed, Nell remembered reading that description in the National Geographic. Still, it was impossible not to resist as she felt herself being pulled under the churning waves, down, down, and away from shore. "I can't let myself get carried out," she thought in a sudden flash of panic. "I can't. If I go out, I'll never get back in." She managed to orient herself long enough to look toward shore and glimpse the candy-striped umbrella. "Help me," she said feebly, her effort to scream ending when the salty water filled her mouth, gagging her. The current that was pulling her out and sucking her under was too strong to fight. In desperation, she flipped onto her back and let her arms go limp. Moments later, she was struggling again, resisting the horrifying feeling of her body being rushed out away from shore, away from any hope of help. "I don't want to die," she kept saying to herself. "I don't want to die." A wave was lifting her, tossing her,
pulling her farther out. "Help me," she said again, then began to sob. And then, just as suddenly as it had begun, it was over. The invisible foamy chains abruptly released her, and she had to flail her arms to keep afloat. This was what they had talked about in the hotel, she thought. She had been tossed beyond the riptide. "Don't go back into it," she told herself. "Swim around it." But she was too tired. She was too far out. She looked at the distant shore. She would never make it. Her eyelids were so heavy. The water was starting to feel warm, like a blanket. She was getting sleepy. "Swim, Nell. You can make it." It was her mother's voice, imploring her to fight. "Nell, get moving." The urgent command from her father stung her senses and succeeded in shattering her lethargy. With blind obedience, Nell swam straight out, then began to make a wide circle around the area of the riptide. Every breath was a sob, every movement of her arms an impossible struggle, but she persevered. Agonizing minutes later, nearing exhaustion, she managed to dive into a swelling wave that grabbed her and held her and rushed her toward shore. Then it crested and broke, tossing her onto the hard, wet sand. Trembling violently, Nell started to get up, then felt firm hands lifting her to her feet.
"I was just coming to call you in," Cornelius MacDermott said sharply. "No more swimming for you today, young lady. They're putting up the red flag. They say there are riptides nearby."
Unable to speak, Nell only nodded. His face creased with concern, MacDermott pulled off his terrycloth robe and wrapped it around her.
"You're chilled, Nell. You shouldn't have stayed in so long."
"Thank you, Grandpa. I'm fine."
Nell knew better than to tell her beloved, no-nonsense grandfather what had just happened, and she especially did not want him to know that once again she had had one of those experiences of being in communication with her parents. Experiences that this most pragmatic of men brusquely dismissed as a flight of youthful fantasy. 17 years later, Thursday, June 8th. Nell set off at a brisk pace on her familiar walk from her apartment on Park Avenue and 73rd Street to her grandfather's office on 72nd and York. From the peremptory summons she had received, demanding that she be there by 3 o'clock, she knew that the situation with Bob Gorman must have come to a head. As a result, she was not looking forward to the meeting. Deep in thought, she was oblivious to the admiring glances that occasionally came her way. After all, she and Adam were happily married. Still, she knew that some people found a tall woman with the slim, strong body of an athlete, short, chestnut-colored hair that was now forming into humidity-caused ringlets, midnight blue eyes, and a generous mouth attractive. While growing up and frequently attending public events with her grandfather, Nell's rueful observation was that when the media described her, that was usually the word used, attractive. "To me, attractive is like having a guy say, 'She's not much to look at, but what a personality. It's the kiss of death.' Just once I want to be described as beautiful or elegant or stunning or even stylish," she had complained when she was 20. Typically, her grandfather's comment had been,
"For God's sake, don't be so silly. Be grateful you've got a head on your shoulders and know how to use it."
The trouble was that she knew already what he wanted to discuss with her today, and the way he was going to ask her to use her head was a problem. His plans for her and Adam's objections to them were most decidedly an issue. At 82, Cornelius MacDermott had lost little of the vigor that for decades had made him one of the nation's most prominent congressmen. Elected at 30 to represent the Midtown Manhattan district where he had been raised, he had stayed in that spot for 50 years, resisting all arguments to run for the Senate. On his 80th birthday, he had chosen not to run again.
"I'm not trying to beat Strom Thurmond's record as the longest-serving guy on the Hill," he had announced.
Retirement for Mac meant opening a consulting office and making sure that New York City and state stayed in his party's political fold. An endorsement from him was a virtual laying on of hands for neophyte campaigners. Years ago, he had created his party's most famous election commercial on TV. "What did that other bunch ever do for you?" followed by silence and a succession of bewildered expressions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.